Good evening. We are continuing the Talmud series. I believe last time we arrived to mitzvah number 180, and we continue now. Mitzvah number 181 is a woman in the time of her period. As soon as she begins to bleed, automatically she becomes impure from the Torah. That's called nida. Nida in Hebrew means, it comes from the word menudeh, nidui. What's nidui? Like putting a person in a ban, isolation. Since automatically she becomes impure, there's all kinds of restrictions applied to her, even to her husband, mainly to her husband. And for instance, according to the Zohar, she's not even permitted in a shul. It's not the halacha. The halacha, she's allowed to come to the shul and not to touch the Sefer Torah. But other than that, you know, according to the Zohar, even looking at the Sefer Torah is making a bad impact. That's the very strong impurity, which is called nida. What happened? From the moment it happens, she has to wait 5 days until all the blood clears out, and then count extra 7 days, which takes about approximately 12 days altogether. And then she's permitted again to her husband, and then until the next period. Now, some women, it comes on a routine cycle, like every 30 days or every 35 days. Some women, it's not steady, depend on mental state, pressure, stress, it can change it. Also using medication sometimes change the dates. The laws are complicated. There's a lot to learn. Before a Jewish boy and a Jewish girl get married, they have to go through a course, which may take hours for him and for her to learn all the laws of impurity. Someone who violates this sin, the man and the woman, which today it's unfortunately very popular sin, that guys and girls have relation without marriage, and a woman always is in a state of nida since the last period she had. She never goes to the mikveh as a single woman. Single woman is not permitted into the mikveh. The mikveh was made to allow a woman to her husband, not to allow a woman to become a prostitute. That wasn't the purpose of the mikveh. Therefore, they don't allow the single women to come because they already understand what's behind their intention. However, if a woman sneaked in, just I'm giving a scenario, and she made a sin, so now she made a sin. It's one sin from the Torah, but it's not a karet. It's not an isur karet. Karet means every time, 36 times in the Torah, Hashem says that in that sin, I cut the soul out of my nation, which means there's two explanations for it. One is that he's going to die younger in age, him and her, or both of them, depend, you know, and the main punishment here is that the karet, unfortunately, has no share to the world to come. It's a very serious thing, unless if they make tshuva. Person who makes tshuva gets his permission to participate in and have a share to the world to come after he makes a real tshuva. But if he dies without tshuva, it's a serious problem. Now, since this law is so severe, such a severe punishment, and actually you should know that a man that stays with his wife and she did not go into the mikveh, she did not dip in the mikveh correctly, chas v'shalom, it's a worse sin than actually having relation with his own mother. This is how bad is this sin. Many of the women that call themselves traditional, that keep holidays and do all kinds of other mitzvot, they have no idea into what problem they get themselves in, the man and the woman. So that's why I say it's a common sin, unfortunately. This is a mitzvah without mazal. Some mitzvot has mazal, have good luck, like mezuzah. Almost every Jew has, almost everyone, 90% at least. Even people who declare they don't believe in God, you come to the house, you find mezuzot. So this mitzvah is mazal. But this mitzvah of nida, which is such a severe punishment, such an important mitzvah, doesn't have mazal, because most of the secular Jews in the world have no idea what is it. They don't understand what mikveh is, what is it for, what does it mean, nida, what do you mean? you know, I went to the shower, I'm not dirty anymore. They don't understand that we are talking about spiritual impurity. We're not talking about physical dirt. That's a serious thing. So if a person did it not intentional, then it's not subject to this karet because it wasn't intentional. Accident, mistake, wrong in a calculation, the wrong check, or the rabbi who checked, because sometimes there's a question if the stains, there's a question if she's pure or not pure. You have to ask an expert. Not every rabbi can answer this. You have rabbis that can give you a lecture from now until Mashiach comes, but they have no idea about these things, because it's like a whole profession by itself. You can be the best dentist in the world, but you don't know how to do open heart surgery. You're only a dentist, or the other way around. You know, just because you name doctor, or just because you name rabbi, not everyone has the authority and the knowledge and the experience. Also need a lot of experience, you know, to be able to tell which stains are pure, which stains are not pure, when does it need a check of a nurse, and all kinds of things. I'm not interested to go too much into the details. There's a lot of details. But this is a critical thing. So if a person did it not intentionally, obviously it's not a karet. But every sin that is subject to karet when it's intentional, when a person made tshuva, is subject to isurim, should know. If a person doesn't on purpose, as I mentioned before, so this is called tum'at nida. A woman that is tum'at nida, she's automatically impure, and she make other impure, you see? So that means she has the power to pass this impurity on. Mitzvah number 182. It's something very similar to this nida. Today it's very hard for us to tell the difference when a woman has nida and when she's zava. But it's another kind of impurity, also with bleeding, relates to a woman. As the Torah says, Ve'isha ki azuf zov dama yamim rabim. There's a lot of explanations about the difference between nida and zava. Today we don't know the difference, which it doesn't matter. When a woman sees blood, automatically she goes into the 5 days, into the 7 days. Also, sometimes when women get to their 40s, or sometimes closer to 50, at one point in their life, they will not receive periods anymore. That's it. The body changed by the biology of a woman, the nature, that eventually she doesn't see any more bloods. Or if she has a surgery to remove the womb, sometimes it happens because of cancer, because of different reasons. At that point, all the woman has to do is to dip one last time in a mikveh, and she's pure for the rest of her life. She will never ever receive this impurity anymore. But however, every time she gets the blood, sometimes when it's the menopause, which is we're going into that time, then the body behaves crazy. Usually it should be every month, all of a sudden it can be after a week, it can be 10 days and 10 days later. The body goes crazy just because before the body gives up on this impurity, it could happen. So sometimes they get confused. They don't know, how can it be? I just came back from the mikveh 5 days ago. How is it possible that I get again period? All these things are complicated. Mainly, as I always say, we don't know not even 1% of the reasons why God made his 613 commandments. Each one in one has thousands of secrets. One or two reasons we know usually. We have an idea what is it about. And over here, the main reason that we can come up with that God made a woman available to her husband on and off with timeouts, because the nature of people is that they get sick and tired from material pleasure, which means everything that a person has, some kind of material pleasure, is just temporary. He cannot extend this pleasure forever. You buy a brand new car, after a month you get used to it. You buy a brand new watch, after a month you're not so excited. You bought a new suit, 2-3 days, you get used to it. You have the most beautiful wife in the world. Being with her every day 6 months, you know, it's already, it loses the excitement of the beginning. And Hashem wanted a man and a woman to be faithful to each other and have harmony and peace and love and all the rest. And he created a system that, since nature has its own laws and people are get used to materialism and they get sick and tired of it, so he made it on and off. like everything else in life. You eat, you need to stop. Then you eat again, then you stop. If you eat the same thing every day, same ice cream, same steak, whatever you like, you cannot enjoy from it anymore. Every day you enjoy less and less, and then the problems begin. Then he say, oh, why the toys are on the floor? Why he didn't clean the window? Why he didn't take the car to the mechanic? Every little thing drives him crazy. And she cannot stand him, and he cannot stand her. Why? Because they pushed it too much. But if they took off, which means now they were together 18, 19 days, then, you know, before they get tired of each other, right away Hashem sent the timeout of 12 days. Everything gets recharged. All the excitement comes to the beginning, and then again, and then on and off, and that's the most brilliant system to protect the marriage forever. Which means you can be married for thousands of years, if it was realistic. You'll never get tired of your wife, and she never get tired of you, because every month it's like a new beginning. And the beginning is the most exciting month, everyone will admit. So people who does not live by these laws, obviously their divorce rate, there's nothing to compare. Or people who lives with this, people who lives without it. You can check the statistics, there's nothing to compare. Mitzvah number 183. Once the woman, she was bleeding, which means Zava, she was called Zava, and she had this impurity. When it's over, when she got cured from these leaks of blood that she had, from that moment, she has to bring a sacrifice. Two birds, she brings it to Hashem, to Bet HaMikdash in the 8 days. She brings it, and after that, she becomes pure completely. Which means as long as she did not finish this kind of sacrifice with the two birds, she's not 100% pure. Only way to do it is to do it with this. Now, mitzvah number 184, the Kohanim, the Kohen, every person that is a Kohen, sometimes a person can be Kohen even when his last name is not Kohen. Could be Katz, can be Rapoport, all kinds of names. Sometimes a person's last name is Kohen and is not a Kohen, and sometimes he's not even a Jew. You understand? Which means his mother's name was Christine, his father's name was Avraham. So Avraham Cohen betrayed Hashem and married Christine, and now they have a son, and they call him, I don't know, Isaac Cohen. He comes to the shul, oh, Cohen, Mr. Cohen, come, make a bracha. Cohen is Bechlal Goy. It's not a Jew, Bechlal. And you have thousands like this, thousands. So make no mistake, we don't go by last names today for anything. Last name doesn't tell us that much. It just give us the permission to ask him, are you a Cohen? Also, sometimes it can be Cohen. His father is a Cohen, and his mother is Jewish, but divorce. And the father married her, and he wasn't allowed, Cohen not allowed to marry a divorced woman. And now this boy called Halal, which now is not a legitimate Cohen. He lost his status. You understand? So in that case, yeah, his last name is Cohen. His mother is Jewish, but his mother is not permitted to his father. They violated the rules of Hashem. Same Hashem that made the laws of marriage, say which marriage is legit, which marriage are not legit. If he told you this kind of marriage is not legit, no matter what you're going to do, you're never going to change it. This is it, and it's never going to work. There's no way to do it. Actually, it reminds me, there was one time a story of a guy who was a Kohen, and he wanted to marry a woman that she's not permitted to him. She was a divorced woman. And he went to one of the big rabbis, I believe it was Rav Eliashiv, and he told him, Rabbi, you know, we just started to get closer to religion now, and we just found out we cannot get married. And we're together for a long time. We already had the time to go to the marriage. What are we going to do? So the rabbi said, what do you expect me to do? What, to change the Torah for you? I'm very sad that you just found out, but it's better now than later. Later it's going to be a big problem after you may have children. So I will pray for you. I will pray for you that the best thing can happen to you. That's it. So the guy thinking, well, if you cannot allow me to marry her, what's your prayers going to do for me? You either allow me or you don't allow me. He say you cannot allow me, finish. Well, you can pray until tomorrow. It's not going to help me, no? But believe it or not, the praise did help. Few days later, he get a phone call from United States. Originally, he's an American guy. And his father is very, very sick in a hospital. And his father say, the doctor say, your father probably won't make it another few days. He wants to see you before he died. So get on a plane and come quickly. What is a good son doing? He comes to say goodbye to his father. He gets to the hospital, and the father say to him, son, there's something I wanted to tell you for many years, but I never had the guts. Now when I'm about to leave, if I don't tell you now, I'll never be able to tell you this. I just wanted to tell you that when you were a baby, I adopted you. You're really not my biological son. You know, so I raised you and I gave you everything and I would leave you all my money, but you're really not my son. And I'm a Kohen, but you're not a Kohen. So the guy started to scream, yes! The father was expecting, you liar, you this. The guy, yes, thank you, God, I'm so happy. Well, the father didn't understand what's going on. I explained it to him. He died peacefully. Even the timing of the confession couldn't be more perfect. Because the only time he would get such happiness is just when it comes to marry this girl. They happily married, and that was the end of that story. So now what happened? A Kohen, he's a servant of God. He's permitted in Beit HaMikdash. He does all the sacrifices, all the slaughtering, all the everything. Now what happened, you know, that the Kohen is not on a shift. It's not his hour now. He's off. It's not all the time there. It's different shifts. And, you know, he walks by and he wants to enter now Beit HaMikdash. I don't know, he want to take something. He left his cell phone there. Something he want to take. He's not permitted to enter Beit HaMikdash just like that to see the beauty of the gold. No. Only when he called to the work, to the service, then he enter. Other than that, he's not permitted. Also, strangers, other Jews, of course there's no permission ever to enter in. But a Kohen, even a Kohen that is supposedly is a servant of Hashem, a servant can come in and out to the king as much as he wants. No, my friend, only when you work for the king. You're not working now for the king, you stay outside. It's not your time to enter. Al yavo bechol et el hakodesh. Will not enter any time into the holiness, the Torah say. Only when he's called to do his job. Why? What's the reasons for that? As again, there's always thousands of reasons. But why? I can give you one reason. Why? When a person can come into the king in and out with no warning, without an appointment, the king is not important to him anymore. It's like my body is in my pocket. I come in and out, he's on a cell phone, like the president. If you is right-hand man, you come in and out, you don't need to knock. Or maybe you knock, you just walk in right away. You know, he's there in a room when he's there. You're with him in a car. You're going to his private bedroom. You see things. You bring things in and out. You know all his secrets. It's not important to you anymore. When you have no, when there's no distance. But here, I can only see you when you call me, not when I want. That's a different story. Psychologically, you respect your work much greater. Then mitzvah number 185. Mitzvah of the service of Yom HaKippurim. Everything we do now today in our days is a memory of what used to take place in Beit HaMikdash on Yom HaKippurim. Special holy day, fast day, day of forgiveness, etc. But everything that we do, for instance, we pray the Tfilat Shachrit, so that's the Korban of the morning of Yom HaKippurim. Then we have Musaf of Yom HaKippurim, all the service, we go on the floor, all these things. You know, it's all exactly as it used to be in Yom HaKippurim when the Kohanim used to do it in Beit HaMikdash. Everything is a repeat. You know, we don't have the sacrifice of Yom HaKippurim, but everything else is the same. So, the Kohen Gadol, now we are talking about the high priest, the Kohen Gadol. Everything that he does in Yom HaKippurim in the right order, sacrificing, confessions, sending the goat. There are two goats, one for God, one Lazazel. What does it mean, Lazazel? Lazazel means like a curse. You're sending him to die. And all the sins of the nation of Israel go with him. You push him from the cliff, he collapses, he dies. All the sins go with him. So this is now all the instructions of the Kohen Gadol, the main Kohen, what to do, how to do in the right order. That's mitzvah number 185. Number 186, not to slaughter kodashim, the holy sacrifices, michutz la'azara. There's a place in Bet HaMikdash called Azara. You're not allowed to slaughter outside. It has to be inside. Technically, what's the difference? I slaughter there and I bring it in, or I slaughter here. What's the difference? It could be that when a person does it, like the Torah says, "Shenemar asher ishchat shor o chesev o ez el petach o el moed lo evio dam shafach venichrat." So what we see here, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu insists that the sacrifice, the slaughtering, will be inside in a place called Azara. Now the Gemara in Masechet Zvachim say, Ashochet ve'amale bachutz chayav al hashchita v'chayav al ha'aliyah. Someone who slaughter outside and now brings it up inside to where he needs to bring, he has two sins here. One is the actual slaughtering outside. That's already one sin that he did. Bringing it in, it's another sin. You made one mistake, don't make now another mistake, bring it in. You understand? What is it like you tell your assistant, I want you to come do it here inside the room that I can see what you do. And he ignore you and he does it inside. And now he say, okay, I want to bring it in. So not only you didn't listen to me, you did it outside. Now you want to bring it to me? Not interested. Which means something like this, right, is it's two sins, two separate sins. Now, also, mitzvah number 187, there's a mitzvah to cover the blood. When we slaughter a chicken, a rooster, or an animal, not a domestic animal, the animal like deer, like they run around, those who are kosher, right, and permitted to be eaten, what's called chaya. There's a difference in the holy language between behema and chaya. Now we are talking about chickens and we are talking about chayot. Once we slaughter them, for instance, when you slaughter a cow, you don't need to cover the blood. You need half a ton of sand to cover all this river of blood who comes from a big cow. But when you slaughter a chicken, so the blood comes out, I don't know, a liter, less than that. One quart of blood, it comes on the floor right away. There's a separate mitzvah. You have to prepare sand before. Why? Because the nefesh is the spiritual thing of the animals. Even the people have nefesh. A person has nefesh, ruach, neshama, chaya, yechida. Five spiritual units in his soul. Five. The lowest out of five called nefesh. Nefesh is in the blood. It's something spiritual in the blood, even though blood is liquid. Liquid is material, right? Like a juice, like milk, like anything you use, it's material. You know, grape juice comes from grapes. It's material. It's something physical. Even though blood is physical, it's much more than physical. The lowest part of the soul is in it. Now, since animals don't have a divine soul, they don't have it. They only have a nefesh. This nefesh revives them as long as the nefesh is inside. Once the blood spills, the nefesh comes out slowly, slowly dripping out with the blood, which is very interesting. Same thing by people, same thing by animals. But the people have more things. They only have things. They don't have reincarnation. They don't have heaven and hell. They don't have a trial. They're not responsible to do good or bad. They are like robots, living robots. They have their own life while the nefesh is in, but they don't have a choice. They don't have a free choice to decide to do a mitzvah or to make a sin. That's why they're not liable to any punishments. Now what happened? The Torah says when you slaughter this, you have to cover this nefesh. First, there's no permission to eat it. That's why we put salt right away to get rid of all the blood. The salt makes the liquid comes out right away. And only if you do it within 72 hours from the time of the slaughtering. If you remember a week later, then it's already too late. Well, what's the point of putting salt? It's already absorbed inside all the bones, all the ligaments, all the meat. It's too late now to make it go out. So it's in now. You're eating it with the nefesh is a big sin. And you're also receiving the bad traits of the animal, cruelty, all kinds of things, by eating this blood of animals and of chickens. So what happened now? When you slaughter the chicken, you know, it takes about a minute until his reflex finish. The nerve system continue to work. Even though his head is off, he can still walk 2-3 steps. I don't know if you ever saw it. And you actually remove his head. The brain doesn't give orders to the body, but the order that was sent already is still in the system. It's like a download. He already received most of the information, and then the internet was cut. But it continued to work another 10 seconds or 20 seconds. Why? Because you're not connected. Because it was already sent. What sent, same thing here. What sent already to the organs was sent. Now there's no more orders going because there's no computer. It was removed, it was cut. But you have to prepare a send. You have to prepare send. And as soon as you make bracha, asher kiddushanu mitzvotav v'tzivanu al hashchita, you slaughter in the neck of the animal. What happened? When the blood is coming on the floor, there's a separate mitzvah. One was the shchita, that's one mitzvah from the 613. And now it's another one. It's not one mitzvah continue. It's two separate mitzvot. So now you take the sand, you make a bracha to cover the sand, and you cover the sand. There's questions in halacha. What happened if your friend was standing there and is an ignorant Jew, and he took it and he covered the blood for you, thinking he's doing you a favor? Now he stole the mitzvah from you. What's the punishment of a Jew that stole a mitzvah from another Jew? Has to give him 10 coins, a lot of money. Just to give you an idea, when a man married a woman, if he did not write her an amount in a ketubah or something like that, what's the average penalty, the average expense? 200 zuz, 200 coins. 200 coins, this is the red line between poverty to wealth. Which means if a person has less, all his wealth is less than 200 dinarim, 200, what happened to a person like this is considered poor and he is permitted to ask for donations for himself and for his family. He's considered poor. He can have 198 in his bank or in his pocket, but he's considered a poor person. In our days, what is this 200 coins? What is it? You'll be very surprised. The amount that it takes you to survive with food and water for 1 year. What's your living for 1 year? Which means, what is the minimum lifestyle of living that I can live without being dead on the street or freeze to death or starve or whatever? What's the minimum that it takes me for 1 year? In America, it can be a very bombastic number because it's very expensive, the life here in New York. But in other places, it can be, I don't know, a few thousand dollars multiplied by 12. From that moment on, if you have more than that amount, you consider okay. You're not a millionaire, but you're okay. You can control, you can support yourself. Less than that, you're allowed to ask for charity for yourself or for your children. What is the amount that a person has to give his wife when he divorces her? Minimum 200. That's if when he married her, she was a virgin. If she came to the marriage already when she wasn't, in that case her value go down by 50%, all he has to give her is 100. Because she doesn't have a value of a woman that is perfect. Automatically her value, a spiritual value, went down by 50%. So 200 zuz is the amount that it will be enough for this woman to survive for 1 year. After that, Hashem will take care of her. He maybe find her another husband. Maybe the children will support her. But this is the minimum he has to give her. How much a person has to give when he stole a mitzvah? 10. 10, it's 10 from 200, it's 5%. 5% of the annual living for one mitzvah. Which means if he stole 20 mitzvot, that's the amount of his living with his family for 1 year. It's expensive. It's a lot. It can be in our day thousands of dollars. even though there is no financial value to a mitzvah, I can ask for $1 billion for it. That's not how much it's worth for me. It's not so simple, because just when you think you're a wise guy, the bedding has a way to prove to you that the mitzvah is worthless for you. Why? They offer you tomorrow, instead of you, let us do it and we pay you such and such. For instance, how do you value a pain? Like Reuven caused pain to Shimon. Now Shimon, he had to go to the doctor, so it's obviously that Reuven has to pay for the doctor bill. He needed a surgery, he pays for the surgery. He was off for a week from his work, he pays for the work. He had an embarrassment, so he paying for the embarrassment, some kind of compensation for the embarrassment that he had when you broke his hand or whatever. But for the pain, how do you evaluate financially how much pain worth? It's very difficult. First of all, because it's not something set. For one person is a gorilla, any amount of pain is nothing. Hit me, it's nothing. There's one guy like me, you give him a little smack, 2 weeks pain, bruise, cannot be. That's very, very difficult, you know? So you want to give me the same compensation that you're giving this gorilla? It's not realistic. So the Torah obviously knows about it. So what does Hashem say? You have to evaluate the pain. The building has to evaluate. So for instance, how much a person is willing to receive to get the same amount of pain again? Which means if somebody burned you, you have now pain for a whole day, it's burning, it's like a bruise on your hand. Now they come and say to you, okay, we'll give you $20 and we want to burn you on the other finger. You're kidding me, $20? No, okay, $200. $200, he's already thinking. All right, let's make a deal. $300 and we'll burn you again, all right? Okay, here, give me the money. That's how much he has to give him. Some person, a person who make, $1,000 a minute, do you think he will agree to get burned for $200? You're going to have to give him $20,000 minimum, right, for such burn. So obviously, let's go on the value of a person. Same thing muktzeh. There's something we call muktzeh michamat chisron kis. Muktzeh, based on the value of the thing to a person. It depends who the person is. I can go to a house of a billionaire. For me, something, a device that he has, oh, wow, it's very important. Wow, look, if I had something like this, I'll keep it in a safe and watch it 24/7. This guy, throwing it on the couch, the kids running, jumping near it, break, not break, the dog is on the couch, doesn't care. For me, it's muktzeh on Shabbat. For him, it's not. Same thing. For me, I'm not allowed to move it. Why? It's michisron kis. But for him, it's really nothing. He loses it, doesn't matter. He's not worried about it. There's other examples like this in the Torah that is go based on the person. Most of the things go by the general rule. Certain things go by the individual. You have to know when and where. Okay, now, so covering the sand is a separate mitzvah. Mitzvah number 188. Shelo li'it'aden ve'achat mikol ha'arayot. There are all the intimate relation crimes. What allowed is your wife. Anything else is not allowed. And it falls into what we call gilui arayot. Gilui arayot, arayot come from the word erva. Erva. In Yom Kippur, in Mincha, which is the most important hour of the year. Mincha in general is the most important hour of the week. Whenever you need really Hashem to hear your prayers, which hour of the week is the best one? Mincha, the last hour of Shabbat, before it's getting dark. It's called in the Kabbalah, Ra'ava de Ra'avin. What's Ra'ava? Ra'ava min Ratzon, a wish. A wish of Hashem. Ra'ava de Ra'avin, the wish of all wishes, which means it's a very special moment. Also, we learned that Mincha, it's a more important prayer than Shachrit, even though Shachrit is about 4 times longer than Mincha. But it doesn't go by how long it is. It goes by the value. And Eliyahu, the Gemara says, Chazal learned that Hashem answered the prayers of Eliyahu dafka be Mincha. in Mincha and not in Shacharit, and there are other ways to prove that Mincha is a higher level. So Mincha of Shabbat, most important hour of the week. Which hour is the most important hour of the year? Mincha of Yom Kippur, most important. Just when Tfilat Ne'ilah begins, and everyone sing El Nora Alila, they open the Ark. It's the last hour of the year. It's the last hour of the judgment, of the 10 days of judgments. The last hour, and we are very close to it. Today is Rosh Chodesh Elul. So that's that, and that mincha we read all the sex crimes not permitted in the Torah. All the list. You should not be with your mother, with your aunt, with this, no homosexuality, none of these despicable acts. Even in some eyes of people, it's all a long time ago, it's not despicable anymore, but in the eyes of God, it's the same despicable act as it was from the day the Torah was given. Nothing changed. Just because people became much more corrupted doesn't change the value of the sin. The sin is still very bad and horrible, and it doesn't matter if 99% of the people in the world will do it. It won't lower the value, the horrible value of the sin. You should know that. The sin is still a destruction in the spiritual world, just as it was 2,000 or 3,000 years ago. Just because people are not aware, maybe God can take it to consideration, considering where we grew up. Grew up in a kibbutz, grew up in China, who knows what. You have no idea how severe is this sin. Fine, of course, God is taking it to consideration. But the actual value of the sin is just as much. You know, when you murder a person 2,000 years ago and when you murder him today, is just as bad sin. Nothing changed, that the value of the life today is not as important. And if we had Beit HaMikdash today, if someone was Mechalel Shabbat, he would get executed. You won't be able to tell, oh, come on, we're in the 21st century. What, you want to be barbaric? This is not Iran here. We're not doing things like this. Look, even in the United States, the arguing, electric chair, the injection of poison, there's a lot of arguments, there's appeals, the governors, everyone is fighting, the Supreme Court. Even here, they didn't make up their mind. You know, some people are a big threat to society. And the Torah said that when they do something, after they got a warning, then they have to be cleaned from the face of the earth. You can have mercy on them, but you have to have mercy on the public more than them. So if you put your mercy to them and the mercy to the people around them, if it's a rapist, you feel bad for him that you have to execute him. Feel bad for 200 women that will get saved. That's much more. Or even to give you an example, when you want to release an Israeli soldier that 5 years, Gilad Shalit, 5 years is in a prison by the hand of the murderers, 5 years already, more than 5 years. Every Jew that has a heart, there's not one day that he doesn't feel bad for him. People pray for him, people hopefully he will be out. But when you consider the more than 1,000 murderers that the Palestinians wants to release for him, it's not question if yes or no, if will happen, maybe yes, maybe not. It's just a question of how many hours it will take. Once you put these 1,000 massive monsters back on the street, it would be hundreds of Jews who will die. Not one, hundreds minimum, if not thousands. So what does the Torah say? You're allowed to save one Jew and kill 300 for him? With all the pain, we have a lot of mercy to him. The heart is broken to thousands of pieces every time his image comes. But why to save one and kill three others? What, their blood is not as red? They're not as Jewish? What's the comparison? Sometimes in life, there's very bad decisions. Okay, so just that we understand, in every constitution, generally, the law came to protect the public from the sinner, from the criminal, which means the judges, all they care about is how do I protect society from this crook, from this thief, from this murderer, from this rapist, from this pedophile. That's all the judge is instructed from the day he goes to law school until he became a lawyer, until he became a judge. There's only one thing that they teach them. The court, the justice system was designed to protect society from criminals. And by the Torah, it's not like that. The justice system is designed to protect society from the criminal, yes, but it also designed to protect the criminal from himself. You understand? Which means punishing the criminal, an educational punishment, it's for his own good. It's not revenge. All the punishments of the Torah are educational. That's why he doesn't get executed right away. He gets a warning. Once he gets a warning and he repeats the same thing, oh, that's a different story already, because you don't want to be educated. You don't want to help yourself, fine, but we give you enough time that you're never going to repeat what you do. You want to continue to do it, that's a different story. So every one of these intimate relation scenes that a woman is forbidden to you, you're not allowed, that's mitzvah number 188. Relatives, a married woman, a woman in a state of impurity, of nida, kissing, hugging, thoughts about her, all kinds of intimate relationship, even though it's not full, partial, it's a sin from the Torah. Right? The Torah says, "Ish ish el kol she'er besaro lo tikrevu legalot erva." In Yom Kippur, you will remember this speech. When you go to Yom Kippur, you pay attention when the Chazan laying in the Torah, in Mincha, they read all the lists. And they say, you cannot have intimate relationship with your mother. You cannot have with your sister. You cannot have this. There's a list of restrictions. When it comes to your own wife, it says, "Ve'elisha benidat umata lo tikrevu legalot ervata." When a woman in a state of impurity, could be your wife, 30 years your wife, happily married, no cheating, everything fine. When she has a state of impurity and she did not go into the mikveh yet, you're not allowed to even come near her by the way that you can smell her or focus on her body or anything like that, or to use the same towel, or to sleep in the same bed, even though you're very strong, you know, like you have full discipline. Just to be near her, that by the way, you're gonna touch her and it would lead to full relationship, it's already a sin from the Torah. Because here, the Torah was more strict. When the Torah warned you not to make a sin with your mother, the Torah say, don't do it. When the Torah spoke about your own wife, or just a stranger woman, another Jew, the Torah say, "Lo tikrav legalot ervata." Don't go near her, that maybe it would lead to a sin. Just going near her, it's already a sin from the Torah. And that's every kind of pleasure that a person gets from a woman that is forbidden on him, it falls into this mitzvah, "Shelo litaden be'echad mikol ha'arayot," 188. Mitzvah number 189. By the way, one more thing about the previous mitzvah. You know, I always said that we do not know 100% how the punishments are in the next world. We know X amount, 90%, 80%. How do we know so much? I can't swear 100% how exactly it's going to be to each individual for his sins. But I have an idea how it's going to be. How do I know? Mainly from the Gemara and from the Zohar. Now, there's a book called Reshit Chochma. It was printed recently in English translation. When someone told me, he said, "You see, you're wrong. You always say that the American Mekarvim, you know, the Ashkenaz world in America, they have a system that they're not ever saying anything about punishment. Only love, love God, love the Torah, the Torah is beautiful. Really, usually they never talk about punishment. They hide that punishment thing from the Torah. Even when they give a speech, that part of the chapter they don't read. If one or two of them is brave, right away he gets a lot of criticism. Ah, why should you talk like this? Just talk about the good. Never bring the bad. Now this book, Reshit Chochma, describes 100% what's happening in Gehenom. 7 different places of the Auschwitz of the next life. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. One below the other. It gives them the name and describe what happens there. The name of the angels, who is in charge of who, what kind of fire, for what sins a person go to the first, second, third, what's wrong, why the seventh one is the worst out of all of them, etc., etc. So one guy came to me and said, you see, you're wrong. They translate the Reshit Chochmah. I said, wow, I would be very surprised. But then he came back to me and said, you were right. They left that part out. They didn't translate that. Why? Sometimes I understand. I have a lecture about it. I never put it in a website. Right? Beginners cannot handle the truth in such level. It's only good for people who are a few years into religion and their weak character. And the only way they understand is sometimes like the kids, when you take away their bicycle, then they begin to behave. As long as you just talk to them, yes, father, you know what, 1 week, no bicycle, okay, I promise, from now he's an angel. Sometimes this is the only way people understand. When people learn what's going to happen to them for specific sins that they do, with his girlfriend, with this, with that, you say, you know what? And I believe me, I have hundreds of emails of people who told me, until I did not watch that DVD you sent me, I wasn't serious. But now when I saw it, I don't play games anymore. It got to me. The message got through. Why? That's the way I am. Not everybody needs it. Some people are very spiritual. Hashem, I don't care about the punishment. What kills me is the embarrassment that I seen, that I didn't listen to you. I don't even go into the punishment. Even if there's no punishment, what really kills me is the thought that I'm ungrateful to you and I'm not listening to you. This is what really kills me. That's a very high level. But some people, it's not. They can't reach this level. The only thing is that what I'm losing. It costs me. Oh, it costs me? Okay, judge, no problem. I'm going to pass my car inspection. Why? It's going to be $300 tomorrow. That's the only way sometimes people understand. So anyway, they're over there, the sixth place, which is one below the worst. One, there is one, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Seven is the worst thing. Seven, it's very limited, only three sins. Chilul Hashem, disgracing the name of Hashem, embarrassing the honor of God as a Jew, as you behave as a monster, makes people hate the religion because of you. Make people speak against God, makes people speak against rabbis, disrespect religion, staying away from religion. You know, all kinds of things, and you are directly or indirectly the reason for it. Seventh place, the worst. Tachtit Haaretz, the bottom of the earth, it called. And then another one, Mechalel Shabbat. Someone who's violating Shabbat on purpose. Not that he forgot or he didn't know the law. He knows today Shabbat, gets in a car, no problem, cell phone, radio, everything, every Shabbat, as usual. Barber, cutting hair, for $100 he sells Hashem. Hashem told him it's Shabbat today. Rabbi, I needed to make $100 in a barber shop. It's a busy day today. So he goes, he cuts hair all day on Shabbat. Very big problem. This is the punishment he's subject to. And wasting seed on purpose. In the sins or all kinds of things, on purpose. It's the seventh place. This is the three that the Reshit Chochmah brings from the Zohar, that is Mador Shvi'i. But Mador Shishi, all the sex crimes, all of them, and the sixth one, which means one, almost the worst level, almost the worst level. You know, even a murderer doesn't fall into the sixth and the seventh section, which means intimate forbidden relation is a very big deal. That's why we have so many tragedies. One out of eight women has breast cancer. Wound cancer, brain tumors, all kinds of problems, tragedies, hurricanes, typhoons, intifada, Hamas, Hezbollah, problem, parnasa, bankruptcies. Why? Everything just like that? Coincidence? Nothing is coincidence. We are paying the price of the way we behave. It's not a Musar Shiur now. If it was, I would read you a letter that the autistic kids publish today. Every month they publish an update. They interview them. If you read, I'm going now to my next Hebrew lecture. If you understand Hebrew, come there. I'm going to say it over there. Unbelievable about what's happening now in the world. And as I said in previous lecture, we are entering, remember, the most critical time in the history of this world, which means if you imagine the Holocaust as the worst thing, the World War, 50 million people die, problems, bombs, Nagasaki, Hiroshima, Paro, Haman, any kinds of tragedy you can imagine, is nothing compared to the days we are entering now. You understand? This is based on the prophets, as the Torah already warned us, that that's what's going to happen, and this is what they say. All of them, 11 different autistic kids, different sources, all of them repeat the same warning, that we are entering the most critical time in history. But after that, those who will survive will have the good, but this time forever, no more on and off. For good this time. What is it like? The Chafetz Chaim brought the mashal. The Chafetz Chaim says, before Mashiach come, it's different time. Up to then, it's a person goes to the supermarket, he buys, he tells the owner of the store, write it in my account. How much? 200? Right. Here is 50, 50 minus. The next day, give me another 200, here is 100, he writes. So the bill is growing constantly, the balance. So as long as the owner of the supermarket is in business, it's not so worry. You come, you give him 100, you charge again 300, you pay 500. Well, yeah, your balance, it's a, you know. What happened when he decided he closed the business next week? That's it. In 7 days, he closed the business. And you come and you say, hey, $300, put it in my notebook. No, no, my friends, you got to pay. No, I don't have right now. You don't have? Vinny, come, show him what does it mean. What happened for years? I buy here, you never gave me hard time. Be quiet. Boom. Okay, where's the money? Okay, okay. Here is the money. This is the mashal. You got the point? HaKadosh Baruch Hu is about to close the business. This place, that's it. We're reaching now the end. No more put it on my account. Now it's time to change or to pay. That's it. That's what it is. And that's it. So all this relationship, forbidden relationships, all these advices from psychologists, from all kinds of bad things, leads us to personal destructions, also to a destruction as a nation. We're paying a very massive price. So that's this. Now also mitzvah number 189, not for a person not to make a sin with his own father. I know it sounds crazy and you don't hear about it, but believe me, if the Torah warned people not to do it, that means it's possible. And it happened. In history, it happens that people even made that kind of sins. So, mitzvah number 190, not to make a sin with his own mother. Imcha hi lo tegaler vata. Mitzvah number 191, not to have any forbidden relation with the wife of your father, your stepmother, even though she's not by your biological mother, since she's the wife of your father, then you have no permission. This is even when he divorced her already. 20 years ago he was with her. And now after 20 years, she became old and you also became old. It could be that sometimes she's younger than you. Your father was 50 and you are 25. And your father, he thinks he's a movie star. So he took a girlfriend, 22 years old. She liked his Mercedes. And they got married and she's younger than you. It happens a lot in Hollywood, all the dirty lifestyle over there. So what happened? 20 years later, your father forgot her name, Bechlal. Since there he had 500 other Christines. So now, he said, oh, remember me? Yeah, how are you? Okay, let's get married. Whatever. It's forbidden. It's a sin from the Torah. Mitzvah number 192, not to have any forbidden relationship with a sister from any side, from sister from the father's side or sister from the mother's side, and needless to say, from both sides. Mitzvah number 193, not to have forbidden relation with the granddaughter from from your son. You have a son and he has a daughter, which means she's your granddaughter. So all these things that you hear on the news all the time, it's a sin from the Torah. You may think the Torah never said, because the Torah never thought that a person can be so sick. Right? The Torah covered everything. Every despicable act that you may think as a normal human being, who's gonna dare to do such a thing? How can you even imagine such a thing? How can you even speak in your lecture about such a thing? Right? It's hard to even imagine. If Hashem put it in his Torah for the public, it means it must be talked. And you have to warn the kids from all kinds of things out there. From this kind of babysitter, and from that guy with his beard, and all the things that you never believe. How did it happen? You never believe. If people would educate their children that the world is full of sick people, and every person, you don't know who it is, no matter what he offers you, stay away from him. You have to train the kids. Someone come, excuse me, do you know where that shul is? Run away. Don't talk to him. Don't talk to him. Come, I give you a drink, something, if you show me. Right away, the kids have to know, to run away, not to stand and talk, because all of a sudden they come out and they grab them. Soon as somebody comes to him, right away begin to run. What's the worst can happen? The guy get offended. Hey, why is running away from me? I don't look like a monster. From 100 times that it will happen, one of them is sick. You know how many kids are kidnapped and you never hear about it? And nobody ever find them. You know how many hundreds of kids from the Jewish community disappeared in the last 10 years? Nobody ever recovered where they are. Think about the pain. It's like Yaakov Avinu. He doesn't know where Yosef is. You raise a kid, I don't know, 13, 14, a boy or girl, one day they disappeared. And you kill yourself. You hire detectives, you cannot work, cannot focus anymore, it ruins your marriage, it ruins your life, it ruins your happiness, it affects the kid, the brother, the sister. Your life becomes a Gehenom here. Sometimes, believe me, they have a relief that the police call after 5 years, we found the body of your son or of your daughter. They have a relief. Living with not knowing who torturing him in some basement and who knows what, it's much worse than knowing he died and he has a shelter to the world to come. His suffering is over. He was a kid. He's tzaddik. He's not a sinner. And I'm telling you, you have no idea what's going on out there. So the Torah had to warn from all these things. Yes, what can we do? We never believe. Hard to believe that we would need this warning for our time. Almost every one of them applies today. Cannot find one restriction in the Torah that sounds strange. All of them became 100% realistic and logical, unfortunately. And so this is 195. Mitzvah number 196. Shelo legalot ervat achot min ha'av. Not to have any forbidden relation from your aunt, from your father's side. Ve'i bat eshet aviv. Oh, so... Your father has a sister, and bat eshet aviv, vehi bat eshet aviv. Your father has a wife, right? How can it be? There's something here not making sense to me. Shelo legalot ervat bat eshet aviv kshetiye achoto. Oh, okay. So your father has a wife. She's not your mother. And she has a daughter. She came to the marriage even though she's not your biological sister. You came from your father and your mother, and she came from her father and mother. Now her mother is divorced, and your father is divorced. They got married, and you live with her together in a house, and thing may happen, not allowed. Mitzvah number 197, Shelo legalot ervat achot av. Your father has a sister, your aunt. You're not allowed to have any forbidden relation with her. Now, this is called Doda, Dodatcha. So you may ask, how can it be? My father is 50, I'm 25, my aunt could be 60. Yeah, not necessarily. She could be the youngest one in the family. She can be 20 and you are 25. Your father is 60, but he's the last sister in a family from 15. It's her. And she could be perfect wife to you. Why not? Cousins get married. Before the Torah was given, people got married with Doda. And then all of a sudden, Moshe Rabbeinu's parents, who were they? Amram and Yocheved. Yocheved was Dodato. Doda, she was his aunt. Now when the Torah came, oh, this relationship is not permitted anymore. You understand? So the Torah say this is not allowed. Cousins allowed until these days. Right? They claim that cousins increasing the risk of birth defect. We have to check into it. If it's substantial increase, the statistic shows something like that, you know, maybe there is something to be afraid of. But I always said, if Hashem permitted that in the Torah, there's no restriction, then there's nothing to worry about. Hashem says it's permitted, it's permitted. Why should it be birth defect? The opposite, sometimes you know who your cousin is. You grew up here, she grew up there. You always see them, holidays, you're together. You know who she is. She kept, she's modest, she's from a good family. You know everything about their family. Every apshi they made, you know. You don't have to investigate now for a year to know who you're getting. This is your cousin. You grew up with her in the neighborhood. You know everything about her. There's a great advantage in it. Great advantage. Problem is, if you don't get along with her, then it creates a mess in the entire family. Now it's become a world war. You know, every side gets his own supporters. The family gets cut by half. And the war begins. Mitzvah number 198. Shelo legalot ervat achot em. Your aunt from your mother's side. Same thing. Your mother has a sister. She's your aunt. Also not allowed. Mitzvah number 199. Shelo lavo al achi ahav. Homosexuality is a very, very big sin in the Torah, who's subject to execution by stoning. The worst kind of execution. And I always say, if God gave such a punishment to all the things, that means he's in their control. However, here we are talking about not only that is a forbidden relationship between men and men, we are talking about your uncle, which means makes it two sins. One is for men and men, which is a horrible sin in the Torah, equal to Mechalel Shabbos. I actually took three of them out of it. And I'm not a therapist, and I'm not an expert, but with the instructions of the Torah and Chazal, I was able to take them out and get them remarried. Married, I mean, not remarried. Married for the first time and happily married. How did I do it? There's a rule in the Torah. The Torah say that a person can decide what he's going to love and what not. Technically, we all attracted to physical pleasures and feelings naturally. Some people are attracted to meat, some people don't like meat, some people like ice cream, some people don't love. You cannot explain why. Some people love alcohol, some people hate alcohol, some people like spicy food, some people cannot even smell it. There's no way to explain why I'm like that and why he likes sport and I hate it. There's no way. But no matter what the situation is, what you're naturally attracted to, it can be changed based on your decision and a hard work. Which means, the Torah says, after the actions, Chazal say, after the actions follows the heart. Acharei ha-peulot nimshachim ha-levavot. Most people say, if I like it, I do it. I have a job for you. What kind of job? First thing, right away. What kind of job? Cleaning the bathroom on the subway. Oh, I hate it. He doesn't even ask how much. Just he heard what kind of job he doesn't want. Some people say, oh, I love this job. Now it's a matter of how much money you pay me, but I love or I hate the job. But really the truth is that a person can get himself used to any kind of job he wants. And he can get himself used to any kind of food. Even though right now he vomits when he sees it. Give him 3 months. You will see that all he eats is this food. And I'm an example of it. And I was in the army every day, eggplants. For 1 week. Box of eggplants. You make baba ganoush, fried eggplants. I could not look at that. They used to burn it. It looks like, you know, the boogies who comes out of the nose. They make mayonnaise. Like I look at that, I vomit. Today,
That's all I eat almost. The salad. What changed? When you have nothing to eat after a few days, so you close your eyes, you close your nose, and you eat. Next day, after a week, you suffer a little less, 2 weeks less, 3 weeks less, 4 weeks. Then you say, no, it's not so bad. Then again and again, 3 months later, where are the eggplants? Which means you can decide, I would love eggplant, and you will, with exercise. You will exercise. You suffer, 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 suffer. The suffering turns into pleasure. You understand? This is how it is. A person can actually force himself to fall in love with a woman. He can force himself. With psychological efforts and work, it can happen. If he doesn't want, it will never happen. But if he really wants, a person can change every bad habits of himself. There's ways to do it. It's a very hard work. Nobody wants to do it. That's why 99.9% of the people fail in their life, because they don't want to sweat. They want everything easy. You're a jealous person, you can work on it. You're a stingy person, you can work. How you work? How a person that is very stingy is afraid to go to the bathroom that he won't have to eat again. Afraid, that's how stingy he is. How he stop? It's a sick person, mentally ill. So how do you save somebody like this? You tell him you start every day to put 10 cents in a pushka box. Today, 10 cents. That's all, Rabbi, only 10 cents? Only 10 cents. And Hashem would love it? 100% charity. He put 1 week 10 cents. Say, next week, now you're going to put 20 cents. Say, what's the difference, 10 or 20? No, let me go. So put 20 cents. Then a quarter, then 50 cents, then a dollar, then $5, then $10. You come 20 years later, half of the town is sponsored. It starts with this. Every time you increase it by a little bit, he doesn't feel the pain. You understand? A little more, a little more, a little more, he gets used to it. Bottom line, a person can force himself to change his habits. You understand? So over here, not only that is not permitted, now he went with his uncle, it's two different sins. If it was a stranger, nothing from his family, it's a very big sin. But now, and since he was his father's brother, it's two sins here. One for this, one for that. Mitzvah number 200, not to have relation with the wife of your uncle. You may say, okay, if she was my aunt, my father's sister, I understand. It's blood relation. What do I have with her? My uncle found her in Zimbabwe now. What does she have with me? She's a stranger. The answer is no. She's considered your aunt also for relationship. Not allowed. And even if your uncle died, no, even if he divorced her, even if he divorced her, you may say, uncle, do you mind? You know, you've 10 years divorced already. She went back to Zimbabwe. I'm going there for business. Where will I find a Jewish woman in Zimbabwe? No, go ahead, mazal tov. Not allowed. Yeah. Even if he died, even if the uncle died, now you may think, okay, when he divorced her, at least his embarrassment in front of my uncle, I married his ex-wife. But when he died, who cares? Nobody even knows who she was. They were married for a week in Zimbabwe and he came back to America. So nobody even knows. Doesn't matter. 1 hour, they were married, finished. Not permitted. Mitzvah number 201. Not to be with the wife of your son. Your son got married, Hashem Yirachem, he divorced her, not divorced her, doesn't matter, not permitted ever. Mitzvah number 202, not to be with Eshet Achiv, your brother's wife. Your brother has a wife, divorced her, didn't divorce her, died, is alive, doesn't matter. Now, however, in the time of the Torah, if your brother married a woman and died without kids, died, I don't know, accident, something happened, died. Now, not only that you allowed, it's mitzvah to do it. It's called yevum.
So one of the brothers, starting from the oldest, whoever comes, one of them has to do this mitzvah yevum. And the boy that will be born will be called after the deceased brother. What happens if they don't want? The brother doesn't want, or the wife doesn't want, or whatever the case may be. Then they have to do a special ceremony called chalitza. You know, he takes his shoe off, she spit on the shoe in front of the bedin, and they make an announcement, kacha yaseh la'ish, this is what the person who doesn't want established descendants to his brother, this is what he deserved. It's kind of humiliation here. But bottom line, once he did that, she's permitted to get married. But as long as she wasn't be meyuvemet, they didn't do yevum, and there was no chalitza, as long as this didn't happen, and as long as this didn't happen, she's not allowed to get married. She's, what do you mean? My husband died, I'm a widow, I want to get married. No, because you automatically link to the brother, and you need permission from the brother. Since today, people have a filthy mind when it comes to men and women, they don't think, I'm going to do a mitzvah because I love Hashem. He goes to her because he thinks about the sin. So what's going on here? Now his brother died, and he has to be with his brother's wife, especially if he likes her. Then he's not going to be capable of doing the mitzvah l'shem shamayim for the sake of heaven. People don't have a clean mind like used to be 3,000 years ago. So today, it's not permitted. Automatically, they have to do chalitza. So even today, if someone has a brother who died without kids, the wife of the brother are not permitted to get married until their brother-in-law goes with her to the Beit Din. They make chalitza quickly, quietly, and then she gets permission to get married. That's called eshet achiv, which means we are now talking when he had kids. There's no reason to do yevum or chalitza. He died with kids. And you want to go and marry his wife as your second wife or as your first wife. Doesn't matter. Not permitted. Mitzvah number 203. Not to be with a woman and also with her daughter. Which means the Torah says, "Ervat isha uvita lo tegale," which means he married one of them. The Torah says like this: "En achiyuv ela kegon shenasa achatchila." When are you guilty? When you married one of them first, ve'achreken sheba lashniya umitchayev. And then, when are you guilty? In a minute you had relation with the second one, that second you violated the sin of the Torah. אבל אם לא נשא אחת מהם, but if you did not marry any one of them, לא התחייב עליהם, לשון אישות וכיחה. So we are talking, here it's different than all the other places. Other places, just one time relation, it's already a big sin. Over here means when you married one of them. You know, so if a person married one of them, then automatically, if it's a girl, her mother automatically is forbidden forever. If you marry the mother, then all her daughters are forbidden forever. Mitzvah number 204, שלא לגלות ערוות אישה ובת בנה. Forbidden relation with a woman and her granddaughter from her son. Miriam had a son named Yosef, and Yosef has a daughter called Rachel. So Rachel is a granddaughter of Miriam. So you were with Miriam, and then you met her granddaughter Rachel, which is 30 years younger. That's already a sin. This is also, every time the Torah say kicha, ikach, ikach means marriage. Lekicha, it means when you buy something. Right? You come to the store, you give the owner of the store the money for the product. The money doesn't buy you the product. Give him a $100 bill, and he's on the way to the shelf to give it to you, and a hurricane attacked the store. Everything fell. It fell from the shelf and broke. Now, if money buy, as soon as he got the $100, then it broke in your position, not his. You lost, not him. Because he doesn't give you the money. He said, well, your vase broke. What do you mean mine? I never had a position on it. Yeah, but I grabbed the money. At that second, that became yours. No, when it becomes yours, when you grab it. You pick it up, or you pull it like this. If it's a car, so you make it make one step forward. If it's a house, you move some furniture here, or you change the lock, or you knock the gate, or you build the gate. You do something in a house that shows that you are the boss here. Otherwise, who's knocking a gate if it's not the owner? Who's changing the lock? Who's bringing furniture? Etc. You have to do something that shows that you became the owner of it. Once you took it, it's yours, even if you didn't pay. Now, in another minute, you're going to get the cash. Now, you're holding it. Okay, I'm taking it. You took it. You didn't pay him yet, and it broke. He said, I don't want it. What do you take it broken. Oh, what do you mean? You bought it already. When you pull it, it's officially yours. So, also women, the Torah, when the Torah speaks about marriage, it says, ki yikach ish isha. When a person take, but there are different ways to say to take. This kind of lekicha means with money. He gives her something valuable, something that worth something. He gives her anything. It can be $2, $1, whatever it is. As long as she agrees, once she receives it, that's already marriage. Today we do it with a ring. What happens if you don't have a ring? You're in the desert. There's no 47th Street. No Mr. Gavriel of Oborokhov. You don't have it. What are you going to do now? You want to get married. So you give her anything. Give her your jacket, whatever. You like my jacket? You're going to use it in the winter? Here, take it. Marry me with this. Whatever you give her. Something that's worth something. Shve pruta. I think pruta is about a quarter today. That's how easy. It has to be valuable. Mitzvah number one. We get to 210 when we finish. Mitzvah number 206. Not to be with two sisters, Michaim, which means, let me explain what it means. A person cannot marry two sisters together. He marries them. Don't ask me about Yaakov. Yaakov was before the Torah was given. After the Torah was given, even Yaakov, even though he did it before the Torah was given, he was holding it against himself. There's a midrash in Tana Deve Eliyahu, it says that in future to come, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is going to make a special meal for all the righteous people after Mashiach comes, after that, it must make a special party for the righteous people. And then when they finish to eat, they give a glass of bracha to do Birkat HaMazon, so they offer it to Avraham Avinu. You are the beginner of everything. And Avraham says, I'm not worthy of it. I brought to the world this wild beast, Ishmael. Look what they did in the world, his children, all the Arabs in the world. I'm not worthy of this glass. And so he passed it to his son, Yitzchak. His son say, I'm also not worthy. Look, I brought Esav to the world. All the Nazis, all the things, the Romans, this. I'm not worthy of this. He gives it to Yaakov. So Yaakov says, I'm not worthy of that. Why? I married two sisters in my life. From life, even though it was before Matan Torah, but for someone in my level, I was, even though they tricked him, he really wanted Rachel, you know the whole story. But still, he was such a righteous person, he held it against himself. I'm not worthy. You understand? And they say to Moshe say, I'm not worthy. Why? Because I didn't enter Eretz Israel, not in my life. And even after I died, I didn't have the merit to be buried there. At least they would bury my body there. No, but I never made it to the Holy Land. That means I'm not worthy. And then in the end, they bring it to David HaMelech. And David HaMelech say, I am worthy. He took the I read it like this. If he did. He took it, I'm sure with a shy face. And he said, Kos Yeshuot Esar, V'Shem Hashem Ekra. That's why we say it in Berakat HaMazon. Kos Yeshuot Esar, Savri Maranan. What's the connection? Because David HaMelech grabbed the hold, and he said, Kos. Kos means glass. Yeshuot, salvation. Glass of salvation, I carry up. V'Shem Hashem Ekra, and I name in the name of God. And everyone say, Savri Maranan, whatever, and they start Berakat HaMazon. Okay, so, I mean, the bracha after Berakat HaMazon. So, not to be married to two sisters at the same time. Not only one after the other when the first one is still alive. Which means if she died, you want to marry a sister, fine. But as long as they're alive, no. What happened if you got divorced with the older one and now you want the second one? Not allowed. שוונאמר, ואישה אל אחותה לא תיקח לצרור לגלות ערוותה עליה בחייה. Which means as long as they are alive, not allowed. One died, then you allowed. Mitzvah number 207, not to have intimate relation with a woman in nida. לא לבוא על אישה, whether she's your wife, whether she's another woman, that she's not even allowed to be with her. So now it's two sins. One is the actual sin that she's not permitted, she's not your wife, you never married her. And on top of it, she was nida. What happened if she tricked the mikveh? She went to the mikveh and she purified herself, your girlfriend, whatever. So now you made one sin only from the Torah, but not a sin of karet because she wasn't nida. You understand? Okay, now, by the way, with the goya, there is no nida. If a person had a girlfriend that she's a goya, it's a very, very bad sin every time he's with her. But she's not. Once she's not Jewish, she doesn't have purity impurity. You understand? By the goyot, yeah, she has her period, but she's not considered nida. But the sin of being with a non-Jewish woman, the Zohar says and Chazal, and that's we learn it from Yosef and other sources, that she tied to him in Olam Haba as an embarrassment forever. Cannot get rid of this embarrassment. It's one of the hardest questions in halacha is which sin is worse. To make a sin with a single Jewish girl, like your girlfriend, whatever, or with Christine. There are sides to here and there. Christine is not as bad as far as Nida, because she doesn't have Nida, so you don't have the karet of the Nida. But being with Christine, you can never get rid of the embarrassment for eternity in the afterlife. So one way or the other, it's a no-win situation. You understand? Now, when the woman converts this goya, automatically from the time she goes into the mikveh, she already, from the first time she sees blood, she's going to be automatically Nida. You understand? So all the laws that applies to a Jewish woman applies to her automatically. And in the time that she goes into the mikveh, she went Christine, she came up Sarah. You understand? She went in, she came up, because there's also extra soul goes into her soul, merged into her soul, and she joined the nation of Hashem. Mitzvah number 208. שלא נטען מזרענו למולך. There's some kind of idol worshiping called מולך. מולך, like מלך, but מולך. The Torah says, ומזרעך לא תיתן להעביר למולך. There's arguments between the Chachamim, how they used to do it. One opinion, that they used to throw the kids into the fire and kill them in front of that idol. One opinion, I believe that's the Ramban, it says that they only pass the kids through the fire, like my son likes to do in the Avdala. Whenever you have the candle, he likes to show that he's a brave guy. They go to the fire, so they used to do like this. They pass the kids, you know, in the fire. Either way, it's Avodah Zarah. So when a Jew does something like this, violating this restriction of the Torah. Mitzvah number 209. שלא לבוא על הסחרים, homosexuality. Punishment for that, stoning and karet. Karet, stoning is one thing. At least you have a share to the world to come. Over here, you lose from both sides. You die young here, execution by the court, and you have no share to the life of eternity. Now you may come and tell me, wait a minute, but there are some of them, since they're little kids, they're like girls. They talk like girls, they behave like girls, some of them look very feminine, they like to dress like girls, they like perfume of women, etc., etc. There's two different kinds of them. Some you don't see by them, they don't look any different. And then it's a big secret, one day they come out of the closet. But over here, they already came out of the closet and the minute they play with the girls in the neighborhood. You understand? So what's obviously there's a difference in their nature. The answer is you're right. But even the feminine one that has the women hormones control more than the male hormones, and they have much bigger attraction to be like a woman, to live like a woman, it's harder for them, but they still have no permission because the Torah did not separate between two different kinds. Oh, you were like this from birth, and you became like this after you left your wife. Doesn't matter. Any relationship like this between men and men, no mercy. It's stoning and no share to the world to come, even if it's hard for him, even if he's not attracted to women, even if he's attracted to both kinds, whatever it is. Usually it comes from extra, being extra parutz, Rashi writes. When a person is so filthy in his minds and in his dirty imagination, he leaves the women and he goes to something that looks more bizarre. But I agree, some of them born with more direction to here. So I always tell them, the same way a guy has strong desire to a woman while he's growing up, 16, 17, 18, in his neighborhood, in his place, in his family, whatever, cousin, you know, all around, especially in the dirty streets that we live in today. And a person who fears God, he doesn't touch a woman until he marries her, right? All these years, which may take 5, 10, 20 years, depending on how long it takes him to get married. There are religious people from birth, 40, 50, 60, and they never got married, and they have this test 40, 50 years of their life every day, every hour. Very strong, very difficult test. But they're not making sins with women. I'm telling you, they're attracted to women, but they never dare to make a sin. Why is it? They know Hashem is watching. Hashem said not to do. Hashem knew it's going to be very difficult for me, but I still will never do it. I have to fight with my desires. So the same thing he has to fight with his desires when it comes to the women, that man has to fight his desires when it comes to a man, which means, yes, it's going to be very difficult for him, and eventually he will overcome the test. Now remember, if a person like this will pray with all his heart to Hashem and receive psychological treatment and all kinds of other treatments that they have, some organization claim they have high success, of a high percentage of success, he can come out of his habits and go to normal habits like Hashem created the world. One way or the other, never dare to say it's not their fault. They're born like this. Never dare to say it, because if it was true, that what you say makes the Torah a lie. You make Hashem a liar by saying it. Because Hashem never gave a person a sin because he has blue eyes. Nobody ever got a sin because they lose their hair. Nobody ever got a punishment because they're short. Did you ever see a person, oh, you know, you born a woman, let's kill you. Oh, you born a man, let's kill you. Oh, you have green eyes, we got to get rid of you. Oh, you don't have a hand, you're born without a hand. Maybe by the Nazim he was... The law, but by Hashem is not like this. A person by Hashem is only punished for choices that he makes. What's in your hand, you are subject to reward and punishment. What's not in your hand, you are not guilty and it's not a merit. It's not in your hand. You're born handsome or ugly or tall or short or healthy or sick. It's not in your hand. And the last mitzvah for today, 210, not to have any relation with animals. And don't think that it doesn't exist. Millions of people do it. Millions in the world. In Germany, in Africa, Brazil. Hard to believe. It's common by certain nations. And a person that does it, Hashem Yerachem, it's also execution for him and for the animal. Now, I will finish with 2 minutes Musar for the ladies and for the men. If a man raped a cow, we understand why he deserves to die. But why the cow has to die? Where is the justice? The cow is standing somewhere in the middle of the field and eating grass, and a psycho person came, and now they have to kill the cow. Not only the cow got such tragedy in her life that this psychopath came, now you're killing her? Where is the justice? Come on, it's a very, very deep question. A woman seduced a man, whatever, they both guilty. But the cow, what do you want from the cow? The cow doesn't have free choice. The cow cannot do anything. The answer is, Hashem says, you're right, the cow is not guilty. But my son lost his eternity with me in heaven because of this cow. It's not the cow's fault. But my son is no longer my son. I'm forced to cut him from eternity. He will not celebrate with us forever for billions and trillions of years. He won't, because of what he did. I cannot look at this cow anymore. What is it like? A father that has a son, and one woman got him into cocaine or heroin and destroyed him, and he died. How can the father look at this woman every time he sees her on the street? It's killing him just from seeing her. Why? You destroyed my son. What happened if it wasn't her fault? Let's describe a scenario. It wasn't really her fault. She had it and stole it from her pocket, whatever. I don't know. It's still. So Hashem say, get rid of this cow also. And you're not allowed to eat the meat of this cow. Once the cow, the court decided to execute the cow, you cannot, if you're the owner of the cow, you cannot run and slaughter it and make steaks. No. It has to be killed. You kill the cow. And this is a wake-up call for all our sisters, all the Jewish female in the world. If a cow that never intended to make a scene with a man, the cow was a victim of a vicious act, the cow has no free choice, and the cow got killed with no mercy, just imagine how responsible you are for the way you dress and what you do with men and all kinds of things that the women do. Modeling, this, playing in dirty movies, going from one boyfriend to another, cheating on them. Who knows? I can't even imagine. Just imagine for every time what punishments you are subject to. Because you have a free choice. You are choosing to do it. You are calling the boyfriend to come over. You hunt him from the beginning. Or he you. It doesn't matter. You cooperate to the scene. 100% with your choices. Dressing the way you are. All kinds of dirty things in fashion today to attract attention. It's very important to be modest. It's not a simple manner. It's a very serious thing. Our grandmothers, from there on, it was almost impossible to find a not modest woman on the street. Ashkenaz, Farah, doesn't matter. I even have a video of the first secular Jews in Hungary, 1933. The Shomer HaTzair, the Zionist movement of Shomer HaTzair in Hungary, became a Chalel Shabbat, eating pork, doing everything you want like Goyot. Look how they dress, better than the Rebbitzin today. Dresses like this. Cover completely. You understand? Look at the black and white pictures of your grandmothers. You find any one of your grandmother dressed like you, and you call yourself religious. I'm not talking one is not religious, it's Hashem Yirachem. Behave like animals on the street. No dignity, no embarrassment, nothing. I always wonder to myself, you know, all these dirty movies, commercial, I don't know, I mean, all the things that they do, don't they think that one day they're going to have kids and the kids will see it? All these goyot and Jews that are not modest, that do all these dirty things, don't they think, now I'm 18, now I'm 20, I'm playing in this dirty movie, but in 10 years from now, I'm going to have kids, and one of their friends in class will bring this movie and show it to my kids. Even for $1 trillion, this embarrassment is now worth. For $1 trillion cash. Forget they do it for $1,000, $2,000, whatever they get. Or a little drugs for 2-3 days. Hard to believe how people can be so stupid. Forget about the desire, the scene. I'm putting it on the side for a minute. Just a person is doing something now that in 10, 15 years is going to be, how they live with themselves. How all these Hollywood stars can live when their son sees that she kissed with another man? This is my father and my mother, everybody see what she does. How low people can be. So who's worse, people or animals? You don't see it by the animals. You don't see a female faithful to her husband. Go to the monkey. Get us a show about the monkeys in the Discovery Channel. She belongs to this gorilla. That's it. She doesn't dare to go anywhere else. She belongs to him and finish. Hard to believe. Hard to believe what's going on. Bezrat Hashem, we'll see you on next Monday's what date? Next Monday, today it's Next Monday, I'm still here. Please follow my events in the schedule in my website, divineinformation.com. Always check on the events before you come. Like last night, lecture got canceled because of the weather. But it will save you time. You would not come all the way for nothing. If it's canceled, we write cancel. If I'm out of town, like I'm going now to Canada, to Phoenix, to all kinds of places, I may not be. Before you come, even though it's a routine lecture, Monday and Wednesday is routine, once in a while, the lecture will not take place. So please always check in events. Check if the lecture, if there's no changes, then means the lecture is on. Thank you very much. We'll see you next week.